Good morning, everybody. Thank you for joining this webinar, the second one in the series, where we are repeating the basics of public address voice alarm to get a better understanding of this domain in general. So today, Jan-Pieter will join me again. Last time we talked about 100 volt system and how that works. Today we will talk about loudspeakers, how to read the data sheets, and how to interpretate the specifications concerning a loudspeaker. Jan-Pieter, application engineer based in Eindhoven, will help us on this next session. So Jan-Pieter, let me give the stage to you, and looking forward to learn about how to read the data sheet for loudspeakers. Thank you.
Okay, thanks, Maarten. Welcome, everybody, from my side. Like Maarten said, today's topic is about how to read a loudspeaker data sheet, and why is it important to understand what is written in a data sheet of a loudspeaker? Well, it will allow you to decide which loudspeakers are fit for your application. Different loudspeakers have different specifications, so if you know and understand why they're there, then you can make the right choice of your loudspeaker. Now, the topics of today, we start with a short overview of the loudspeaker categories we have within Bosch for the purpose of voice alarm and commercial sound. Most loudspeakers, as you know, are 100 volt loudspeakers. And then we dive into the loudspeaker data sheet. We'll talk also about sound and frequencies and things around it, so that you have a better understanding on what a loudspeaker should be able to do. So let's start with the loudspeaker categories. The first one is ceiling speakers, obviously mounted in the ceiling. We see them a lot in large buildings, offices, schools. Then we have cabinet loudspeakers. Cabinet loudspeakers are best speakers in general for music. We'll see them mounted on a wall in a bar or in a room where you need music. Column loudspeakers, those are those long loudspeakers, mostly used for speech. You see them in churches and rooms like that. Line arrays are similar to columns with some better steering to the audience. So you see them in auditoriums, also in airports. Then sound projectors, there with a sound projector, you can project the sound in a certain direction. And the last category is horns. Horns have a high sound pressure level. You see them outdoors often. So the typical use, typical applications for ceiling loudspeaker, you see them in a wide variety of applications. Flush mounted in the ceiling, obviously, but there are also accessories where you can use them as a pendant version, so from a wire from the ceiling. Cabinet loudspeakers, most of the time wall mounted, very good for music. You have a very most of the cabinet loudspeakers have a good frequency response, so good to use for music. Column loudspeakers, those are those rectangular housings with a number of drivers and loudspeakers inside in a vertical line, and the result of that is that you have a stronger sound beam, which you can use for speech applications. Now, line arrays, actually the housing is the same as a column loudspeaker, but line arrays are optimized for beam steering, so very good for speech applications. We have them in a passive and an active version. The active version is a powered version, actually a powered loudspeaker, the Vari. So that is a real nice loudspeaker to be used in auditoriums, where you can actually beam the sound right to the audience where you want to have it. Then sound projectors, you can direct the sound with a sound projector, so you can move it into a certain direction. Like for instance in a museum where you have a certain spot where people should be listening, or walk past corridors in malls or something like that. And then finally the horns. Like I said, a horn has a high sound pressure. They can produce high sound pressures, so that they sound really loud. Very well for large distances. You see them mostly outdoors. And also in environments where you have a lot of noise, like in factories. Okay. Where can you use these loudspeakers? What is the typical use of those loudspeakers? Ceiling loudspeakers is general use. You can use them for speech, and some of them you can also use pretty good for music, because they have dedicated loudspeakers for lower frequencies. Cabinet loudspeakers, like I said, they have a good frequency range, most suitable for music, but they can also be used for speech. Column loudspeakers, very, very good for speech. Line arrays as well. It's a better version. And sound projectors, you can use them for speech. Like I said, you can direct them into a certain direction, so depending on your application. And then horns, better not use horns for music, but you can use them for speech in the outside. Now, this is just an indication. Be aware that maybe some ceiling speakers with dedicated subwoofers could sound better than a general cabinet loudspeaker. So it's just an indication on which type of loudspeakers you can use for which applications. Now, let's dive into the data sheet. It's important to know what is written in a data sheet of a loudspeaker to be able to make the right choice. But then you also have to understand what is written in it. There's a lot of data in the data sheet. And if you see this for the first time, I can imagine that you do not understand what it's all about. So you have to understand what these specifications are, and then you can make a good choice of your loudspeaker. Our data sheets are mainly have four subjects, which we're going to discuss as well in this series. We're talking about specifications, installation, the environment, and accessories of those loudspeakers. Start with the specifications. Electrical definitions. In the data sheet, you see some electrical definitions. One of them is rated power. Now, rated power is the power of a loudspeaker, or a 400 volt loudspeaker, actually the transformer. It was designed for to handle under normal conditions. And now all these loudspeakers, all voice loudspeakers, are tested. They are put in a room for 100 hours. And then they should operate at rated power for those 100 hours, and afterwards, when the test is over, they should still behave the same as before they went into that test. And this is what they call PHC, power handling capacity, and that is defined in the IEC 60268-5. So it's a standard. Yeah, if you state in your data sheet that it complies to PHC, then it has to be tested like that as well. Sound pressure level, quite important for a loudspeaker. Also, sound pressure level is also defined, how it's measured and things like that. It's the loudspeaker is causing air in front of it to move, and that is creating this sound pressure. The higher the sound pressure of a loudspeaker is, the louder it will sound. So we see that with horns, like already said, they can have a high sound pressure level, they produce a louder sound. Then the opening angle or coverage angle, also sometimes you see coverage angle in the data sheet. This determines the coverage of the sound of a loudspeaker. Now, be aware that sound is directive. The higher the frequencies, the more directive a loudspeaker will be. You can see that here on the right side. The opening angle of a loudspeaker at 1000 Hertz, at 1K, is 145 degrees, and the opening angle of that same loudspeaker at 4000 Hertz will be less, it will be 130 degrees. So that's important. If you have to cover a certain room with a number of loudspeakers, it's important to know what the opening angle is. You look at sound pressure level in a little bit more detail. The quietest sound we can hear is our 0 dB definition. That's our reference, and that's actually 20 times 10 to the power of minus 6 Pascal. You can see that on the right and on the bottom. Below that, we cannot distinguish anything anymore. This 0 dB is the threshold of hearing. So yeah, below that it's not able to distinguish any sound anymore. The sound levels are different for different environments. If you look on the right in this picture, you can see, for instance, in an office, in general, the sound pressure level is around 65 dB. On the street, it might be 85. A band playing could be over 110 dB. And then we go up to the threshold of pain, where, you will not be able to hear anything anymore. Now, sound pressure is also related to distance. Loudspeakers are measured for their sound pressure level at a distance of 1 meter. And then the loudspeaker is operated at 1 watt. This is defined in the IEC 602685. So if you see these definitions, they have to comply to this. Now, for instance, this loudspeaker here has a sound pressure level of 90 dB at 1 meter, 1 watt, 1 meter. One thing you have to be aware of is the distance. If you double the distance, if you move away from a loudspeaker or when the ceiling, for instance, is higher and you have to mount it a little bit higher than 1 meter from the listening plane, the sound pressure level is reduced by 6 dB. So if you double the distance from a loudspeaker every time, the sound pressure level will be reduced with 6 dB. So for instance, here on the right side in this example, at 2 meters, so twice the distance from 1 meter, the sound pressure level is reduced with 6 dB. So instead of 90 dB, you will have only 84 dB left at the point of 2 meters on axis straight below here, the loudspeaker. Now, this is considered to be a point source, a single loudspeaker, but for line arrays or cones, the distance, doubling the distance will result in a reduction of 3 dB instead of 6 dB. So be aware of that. The reason for that is that a column loudspeaker or a line array, the sound is progressed in a cylindrical way and not in a spherical way, like with a point source. So that's the difference. So keep that in mind. So a column loudspeaker has, let's say, a better sound pressure performance compared to a point source in a single loudspeaker. Frequency response. Now, this is quite an important parameter for a loudspeaker. And we will dive into a little bit more detail about frequencies. If you look at a data sheet, you most likely will also see a graph like this, the frequency response of a loudspeaker. Now, what does it do? It shows you the sound pressure level of that loudspeaker at 1 watt, 1 meter for different frequencies. So it's an indication how well this loudspeaker can perform for different frequencies. Now, sometimes also in the data sheet, you can see that the sound pressure level at a certain frequency is mentioned. like here you see at rated power and at 1 watt, 1 kilohertz at 1 meter. Now we've seen the example already, the loudspeaker that we used at 1 watt, 1 meter had 90 dB SPL. Now, if you have a loudspeaker that like this LB2 here, it's a 30 watt loudspeaker, then obviously the sound pressure level at 30 watt is much higher. Now, how can you calculate that? You can calculate that with this calculation method over here, 10 log of the rated power. So if you fill that in, 10 log of the rated power will give you 15 dB, and this 15 dB you will have to add to the power at 1 watt, 1 meter. So the performance of this loudspeaker, this 30 watt loudspeaker, the sound pressure level it can deliver at rated power is 90 watt plus 15 is 105 dB. You can see this also in the data sheet. Now looking at the frequency response, in the ideal situation, you would like to have a straight line here. So from left to right, a straight line, that is a very good loudspeaker. I have not seen them yet. So if somebody can produce a loudspeaker like that, then I think you're a millionaire. The reason for that is that to be able to reproduce the sound in the most natural way is to reproduce every frequency at the same level. So that will be then a straight line. Now, this is not possible, mainly due to physical conditions of a loudspeaker. If you look at those frequency response graphs, you can see here the maximum here at 1000 hertz is around 90 dB, like specified. But if you go 3 dB lower, have the power, you can already see that the performance is a lot better. You can have already a frequency, an equal frequency response between, what is it, 800 hertz and maybe 7000 hertz or something like that. So here in this area, it's already quite equal. If you go even lower, if you lower it down, the sound pressure level, minus 10 dB, you can see that the range is really good. You have here a range of 95 up to 20 kilohertz, and that is sometimes what you see also in the data sheet. A thing called effective frequency range at minus 10 dB is 95 hertz to 20 kilohertz, but then be aware that it's it is at minus 10 dB. Now let's look at frequencies. Frequencies is quite important, of course, for a loudspeaker and the human hearing. The human hearing is, it's able to hear frequencies between 20 and 20,000 hertz. That's generally accepted as the frequency range that humans can hear. Now, there's one thing about these frequencies that is, when you're getting older, the upper limit, the 20,000 hertz, will go down. It's, in my case, I can hear about maybe 16 or 70,000 hertz. You will lose the higher frequencies. You're not able to hear them anymore. In the old days, when they used still the old telephonies, they found out that a small frequency band of somewhere between 3,000 and 300 and 3,400 hertz is sufficient for voice, for speech, to understand what somebody is saying on the other side of the line. That frequency band is enough. Now, in order to be able to differentiate between different people's voices or instruments, you will have to understand how sound is built up, and due to lack of harmonics, we'll talk about that in a minute, and overtones, you will be able to say, this is a certain person talking, I recognize his voice, or this is a certain instrument that is due to this. We'll have a look at that now. First of all, the fundamental frequency. This is the lowest frequency of a vibrating object. This is called the fundamental. Each object will have that. Well, it's basically the lowest frequency at the lowest audible pitch, which is predominant in this in a waveform like voice. If you look at the male voice, this the fundamental is around 120 hertz. A male has a lower voice compared to a female, where it's 240 hertz, and a child around 300 hertz. So that is what determines the pitch of a voice. Now, looking at words, they're made up of vowels and consonants. Vowel has a typical frequency of up to 1 kilohertz, and consonants have a typical frequency between 2 and 4,000 hertz. And the consonants are most important for speech intelligibility. So if a loudspeaker cannot reproduce frequencies between 2,000 and 4,000 hertz, you will have a problem. Also, if the amplifier is not doing a good job there, then you might have lots of problems in relation to speech intelligibility. Now, if you look at different frequencies for music, obviously a large bandwidth is required to be able to hear what kind of instrument is playing. If you look, for instance, at cymbals, the fundamental is around 3,000 hertz. If you cannot cover this bandwidth, then you will not. Yeah, you will hear something, but you might not be able to say, "Ah, it's a cymbal." Or maybe if you cannot go as low as 100 hertz, then you will not be able to recognize a kick drum or a bass. So frequencies are very important. And so with loudspeaker for music, that has to be able to reproduce all these frequencies as good as possible. Now let's go into harmonics and overtones. A single sine wave is actually a fundamental frequency without any harmonics. So it's the sine wave as it is a fundamental at its own. But if you look at, for instance, the word, if you look here in the on the right side, the word hello looks like that. So that's really complex combination of waves. So it's a combination of different frequencies combined to each other. Now, the addition of harmonics and overtones to a waveform will make it possible to distinguish between different sounds like voices and instruments, and that's what we call the timbre. So that's where you can say, okay, this person is talking or that music instrument is playing. Now, what are harmonics? Harmonics are a ascending series of components, sonic components that sound above the audible fundamental frequency. So if you look here on the right side, we'll explain that. The harmonics have a lower amplitude than the fundamental frequency. So you look in the top sine wave, then the second harmonic, so the sine wave's first harmonic, the second harmonic below that, the amplitude is lower. So if you, for instance, look at the top here, let's say if you look at volts or sound pressure level, for instance, if this is maybe 10 volt, then this would be 8 volt and this would be 6 volt, etc. So the amplitude will be lower for each harmonic. The higher frequency harmonics that sound above the fundamental make up the harmonic spectrum of the sound. For instance, if you look at the fundamental here, the first harmonic is, for instance, 100 hertz. Then the second harmonic is 200 hertz. The third harmonic is 300 hertz, and the fourth harmonic is 400 hertz, and so on and so forth. Now, overtones are actually frequencies which have no direct relation to the fundamental. So if you have a fundamental frequency of 100 hertz, then an overtone could be, for instance, 120 hertz or something like that. So no direct relation to it. Now, if you add all these things up, if you add all these harmonics and overtones, if you put them all together, then you will have the timbre of the instrument of or the person talking. Okay. For example, I have recorded the word parrot. Now I had some problems with the server. I could not, let's say, play any sound. I will try to share some sound with you. Just a minute. I will look for the file. I have spoken the word parrot just to let you hear what it means if you lose some frequencies. Now I have to look for the file and I hope you can hear it. Okay, this is the word parrot. Just listen to it.
Parrot.
Could you hear that, Maarten?
Yeah, I could hear it.
Okay,
thank you. Jan Pieter, thank you.
I will play it once more then.
Parrot.
Okay, so this is how the word parrot sounds in there when there's nothing strange with it. If I go back to the PowerPoint. Now I put an EQ to this, to the same word. So I took the WAV file and I removed all frequencies below the 300 Hertz and above 1000 Hertz, like this. Now I will go back and share. So here's what I've done. I took the parrot wave, took out the frequencies below 300 and above 1000 Hertz. Try to share that file with you as well. Just a minute. Comes.
Parrot.
Was that audible, Maarten?
Yes, I could hear it. I saw in the chat that some people cannot hear it, but I was able to hear it. Yeah.
Oh, okay. I'll play it once more. Maybe they hear it now.
Parrot.
Yeah. Some people say they can hear it. Some people say they cannot hear it. So yeah.
Okay.
Okay.
Well. The reason why I wanted to show you this or to listen to this is that when you lack some frequencies, you will not be able to hear what is being said. In the last example, it was not really clear that the word parrot was spoken. So that is obviously important then for loudspeakers as well, that they are able to reproduce all frequencies in a good way. Let me move on to the next slide. If you look, for instance, at a horn loudspeaker, we see here the frequency response of this LBC 3483/00. This loudspeaker has a frequency response that starts here at around 200 Hertz and then goes up to this point and then back at around 8000 Hertz. So this is a really small frequency response which we can use actually for speech here in this area. So it will be good, but you can see above the 8000 Hertz you will lose all those frequencies. So for music, it's not the best loudspeaker. Now if you look at the frequency response of an LB6, this is a different story. Here you see that the frequency response covers a larger range. It goes way up to 20,000 Hertz, and here you will see an additional frequency response which goes up here from what is it, 40, 30 or 40 hertz, then up to this point here, the crossover frequency. Now this frequency graph here is from the subwoofer. So it's this loudspeaker here, the subwoofer, is dedicated for the low frequencies. And added to that, we have the satellite loudspeakers, those small ones here, and they will cover the higher frequencies. And here at the crossover point, they will meet. And the result is quite a large frequency range. You can see that from here over up to 20,000 hertz. So this is really a nice set of loudspeakers for music. Then the last thing I want to tell you is the frequency response in relation to EN54-24. Yeah, some loudspeakers for voice alarm systems installations are tested or certified for EN54. Now, what does that mean in the standard? It says that a loudspeaker will have to be able to reproduce the sound in a certain sound pressure level in a certain frequency range within this white area. So here, if you start here around 500 hertz, then the frequency response have to be equal and not deviate too much from those from this area, and goes all the way up to, well, almost 8000 hertz over here. So you see the red line here, this frequency response of this loudspeaker, the red one, that loudspeaker will be certified due to this standard. But the blue one here, where it drops already minus 5 dB over here, it will not be certified. So this is one of the things that you can see also in the EN54. Okay, so this was basically it. This is the end of the first part. Next week we will have a second part where we will look in more detail into the specifications, high sound pressure loudspeakers examples, the coverage angle, opening angle examples, and we look at loudspeaker sizes and types, and on the installation side, rated voltages and tappings, mounting methods. And the environment, we look at IP ratings, a short overview, and accessories for ceiling speakers. Like you said, pendant loudspeakers, we have those kind of accessories as well.
Okay, yeah, thank you.
Are there any questions?
Yeah, there was one question. What is the most effective frequency range for speech and music? But I saw that question coming in before you explained all the frequency ranges. So I think that one is more or less covered. Then there is a question. Will you explain polar diagrams?
Yeah, that is, well, not in detail, but the polar diagram explains you the actually the opening angle. We'll talk about opening angles or coverage in the next session.
Okay, that will be in the next session. I think that's about it. I don't see any other questions on this one. No, Jan Peter, that's it. So I think everything answered.
Okay, good.
Okay. Then I think it was again interesting. We had a lot of participants, almost 80. So yeah, looking forward to the next session and see the basics unfold in total. Yeah. Okay. So these are the next sessions. So 2nd of December, I see this correctly, right? Then will be the second part of the data sheet. Can you give a glance? What will be in that? Will there be the polar diagrams, for instance, in there?
Yeah, like I said, I have an overview here. This is what we're going to talk about. This is for next week. So we'll talk about coverage, opening angles of a loudspeaker. I will double check if I mentioned the polar patterns, but okay, it's related to that.
Yeah. Okay, then thank you. Let's, if there are no further questions, let me check once more, then let's close the session. I do have another question here. So what is the question? Is there a design tool for loudspeakers?
a design tool for design a loudspeaker or to do what with it?
This is the question, how it is listed. Is there a design tool for loudspeakers? I don't know, maybe they refer to how to project a loudspeaker, that you can see how is the opening angle reflected in the area.
Yeah, it's that there are modeling tools. The most common one we use within Bosch is Ease. We have also a session next year about Ease Address, and there you will see how actually a loudspeaker will behave in a certain room. So what the sound pressure level is at a certain height, a certain listening height. And then that's a simple program, but you have, let's say, very sophisticated programs. You have to be really knowledgeable about those the software on what it does. It also you can build rooms, you can build whole models of a building actually, and then you can simulate how a loudspeaker is behaving. But then you have to be really really much aware of what you're doing and what parameters to use, of course.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, here is a question. I think it goes a bit in the same direction. How do we select the right speaker for places of worship and accommodate for echo?
Yeah, echo is, let's say, a room acoustic thing. You cannot prevent echo with a loudspeaker, right? It's impossible. The only thing you can do to prevent echoes is to steer the sound in a certain direction, where people are sitting or where people are standing, like on an airport or in a church or whatever. You will have to aim at the at that area to prevent echoes or reflections, right? That's the only thing to do. So in a church you will see column loudspeakers. Yeah, and the very good one are the XLAs from Bosch, the extended listening area, where you can point the beam of sound directly to where the people are standing or sitting. And then the best version we have is the Varia, that has some DSP inside. You can configure it for any room, even if it's if it has a tilted floor, like in a theater or something. So best things to use is then a line array or a column.
Yeah. So what are the most suitable speakers for such buildings, churches and mosques? You say line array speakers or column. You have specific models that you would like to mention?
We see the Vari. The Vari, that's an active line array. The advantage of that one is that you can mount it vertical to the wall, so you will not have to tilt it. You can just mount it vertical to the wall, so it blends well into the environment. Architects will like it, and then you can with software you can configure it in such a way that the sound is projected to the area where the people are. So yeah, that's the best the best solution for a mosque.
Yeah, and if you are looking for something more price competitive, if the line array would be too expensive, what's the cost effective alternative?
A column, a simple column loudspeaker, where you mount that to the wall and aim it to the people where they are sitting or standing.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Yeah,
and then the cheapest is a horn loudspeaker, of course. But okay, then you also have the sound will be not the same, right?
Yeah. Okay. How can a wall-mounted cabinet speaker actually reach 150 meters?
How much meters? 150?
Yeah.
Yeah, that's impossible.
That's impossible.
Well, we have actually Electrovoice has a new loudspeaker, and I think it can reproduce 155 dB. But then doubling the distance, you will lose 6 dB all the time.
Mm-hmm.
So you can make a calculation.
But you should not be too close to the speaker then, I guess, right?
No, it will blow your ears. But those are specifically designed for large spaces like stadiums and stuff like that. So with such a speaker, you could cover a larger area, but 150 meters is quite a lot. what you see at festivals at sometimes is that they at a certain distance they have an extra stack of loudspeakers with a certain delay, so you have the same sound in time, so they are time aligned. You have the same sound, and that loudspeaker then can reproduce sound at a higher volume, of course, and then you can cover larger areas. That's how you can do that.
Yeah. Do you know the model name of that Electro Voice unit, or not by heart?
MTX or MX, MTX, something like that. I don't know it by heart, but it's three letters I know. But
okay. Then a question: if the column speakers have a very narrow beam, is that true? Mm-hmm.
Yeah, because you want to steer them in a certain direction. So the beam of a column is quite narrow. You will need a certain amount of columns, obviously, to cover a certain area. But coverage we'll talk about next week.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Somebody from the audience gave a hint. It's the Electro Voice MTS. That's the
MTS. That's it. Yeah.
That's the one we talked about. Yeah. Okay. I think that's it. I don't see any more question. So, in that case, Jan Pieter, thank you again once more, and looking forward for the next session. All the
thanks
participants,
everybody.
Thank you for joining, and make sure that you join next time when we continue. Okay, thank you. Bye-bye.